So sorry for the delay. I had to set up a lot of those screens. So forgive me. I think we're live. Yeah, we're live on YouTube. We're live on Facebook. And we're live on Twitch. So today joining us, we got Delicate Beats. We're going to be talking about synchronization on TV, film, how to think outside the box when it comes to your music, because it's a lot more than just, you know, making music for artists specifically. So let's kick up the Discord. If you want to join in, I'm going to leave the Discord link on the YouTube chat. Or just go to busyworksbeats.com/discord. Click here to join the conversation. All right, I'm going to pin this there. Do this. Okay. And then let's hop on Discord and let's start this event on Discord. So either one, you could join on Facebook or you could join on Discord. Either one is cool. Let me move this screen. I'm realizing I'm doing it backwards. Okay, there we go. Refresh. Cool. Boom. Okay, start. Yes, let everyone know. All right. Boom, boom. There we go. There he is. Let me turn your volume up. Thank you for your patience. We got Delicate Beats with us. I'm gonna invite him up here and we're gonna get this conversation rocking. We are live on YouTube. We got Diavani here. We got DJ Wraith is here. What's going on? Wednesday at 3 p.m. Eastern. So I have a lot of conversations scheduled for today. Today's like the combo day. I wanted to chat with Delicate Beats. Here he is. And I'll also be live on Clubhouse and IG later talking about other things. But yes, I understand Discord for the first time, it's hard to get the mic working. So I'm gonna make sure you can get the mic situated. We don't hear you, but it's all good. I think in the audio settings, also Delicate Beats, if you could hear me, there's like a noise cancellation feature. You just gotta turn that off because it, a noise suppressor, it doesn't help. It makes it worse. Brazil is here, what's up? We got Content Daddy, we got Raw, we got Serum God is here, the new top dog for the Avengers. We got Kid Odin, there he is.
Let me know if the volume's too loud or something, because I can't really see, there's no like meter.
Oh no, you can crank it even harder.
Oh yeah, okay, so let me see, 1, 2, 1, 2, check.
There we go, yeah, there we go.
That's better?
Yeah, perfect, perfect. What's going on, man, how you feeling?
Doing great, doing great. Been writing some tunes this morning and was looking forward to, you know, talk about what I do for a living and try to help the community do the same.
Dope, dope. There it is, because I saw you with a lot of people that I know. So, you know, I gave them a little context. I told them how instead of chasing artists all day, there's other opportunities. And that's where I wanted to bring in this conversation, because you're actively doing things in this world from that lens. So I guess, yeah, just explain to people the unique angle that you take and maybe go ahead.
Sorry. I'd like to give a bit more context, because I feel like a lot of people will kind of see themselves through my experience. But yeah, so roughly 25 years ago, that doesn't make me any younger. I started to make beats, and I was a hip-hop producer like most of you people out there. And I was chasing rappers around town, because at the time there wasn't really any social media to sort of reach out to artists, right? So I was going up until the point where I was 18, I was just doing beats at home. But then I started to go out, bring my CDs in with me, and would go to clubs. And I would try to network with artists like in local shows. So I would pass out my beat CDs. And after a while, I started to sell those beats for like 30, 40, 100 bucks, right? And I wasn't really planning on building a business at that time. But, you know, why not make a few quick bucks and buy a few new plugins while you're at it, right? And so I did that for a very long time, but then I had to choose a career, right? My mom said, you know, you got to go to college and we're paying for everything, but you need to go. So I did, and I did not choose music. I became a graphic designer, and I did that for, I would say, 12 years. And long story short, I hated the 9-to-5. I wanted to be my own boss. I wanted to have power over my time, my schedule. I didn't want to essentially give my life away to someone else, to another corporation. I wanted to control everything. So I started to see music as a way out, and I was really, really passionate about music. So I wanted to see if there was a way for me to join. We say in French, because I'm French, by the way, if my accent is somewhat weird sometimes, join like the necessary with the essential, right? Or essentially what is nice in your life and what is necessary. and so I started to research online how to make a career out of music production. And at that time, mind you, it was like 10, 12 years ago, there was no real resources online. There was like a few guys. I don't know if you remember Postman, for example.
Sorry, my mic muted. Yes, Postman for sure. Shout out to Postman.
Yeah, he's a big legend, right? And so I started to see these guys online talk about, you know, selling beats online. I was like, huh. I don't have to go to shows, wait up until like 3:30 in the morning to pass out my beat CDs to local rappers anymore. So I started to dabble with that, but I didn't see a whole lot of success, right? I was on MySpace and I was trying to hustle beats here and there, but that didn't work. So then that stayed that way for a very long time, at least 5-6 years. And then one day, my best friend told me about this website he was selling beats on, and was starting to pay for groceries. He was paying rent with that money. And I was like, I want in. Tell me what that is, what I got to do to get on that website. And so sure enough, he said, yeah, no problem. I actually know the owner personally. The website was premiumbeat.com. So for people who don't know, premiumbeat.com is pretty much now the biggest stock music platform in the world. And it's been created by a guy here in my hometown of Montreal, Canada. And that website blew up, and I was very lucky, because when I got in, I was a hip hop producer, and I talked to the owner and I said, do you actually need hip hop music, right? Because I saw all these other genres, such as, you know, the corporate type music and then the classical stuff and all of that. But luckily enough, he said, you know what? Hip hop is the most visited section on my website, and I don't have like authentic sounding, really good hip hop. So you're more than welcome to build that section with us. And so I started to make these hip hop beats on this website. And after a while, I got my first quote unquote bestseller, right? And that song became the best selling hip hop track on Premium Beat for at least a year. And I started to get those really nice placements. And I guess that's where the whole thing about music licensing can start now. I don't know if you have any questions about what I just said.
Oh, no. People need to know the history of, you know, how we evolve into these perspectives. Because the biggest thing is we learn from people who were early. Like, for example, I was early into YouTube. So if I taught people that it was so easy to get into YouTube nowadays, it may be easy, but what I'm saying is the conditions are different. So like the way I came up, understanding that story, they can now understand how they can come up, or the philosophy of being first to something, or navigating to know the owners, to, you know, try out new platforms and different things. That's why I think these stories are important. So yeah, thank you for the backstory, because they need to know that you learned about this and discovered it. It wasn't just something you set out right away to do, from what I'm hearing.
Yeah, for sure. So also, I want to point out that I worked with rappers and singers for a very long time. And the thing is, and I'm sure most of your producers on your community know that, we producers are more organized, right? We seem to have a better knack for having visions on songs and production and what the song needs in order to be a classic, right? And so I got super frustrated. Like the rappers who were coming to my place to record were always late, or sometimes they were drunk or hungover, and they were really talented people, but they were not acting as professional, and I really got tired of that. So that's also what drove me to look for ways to just sell my instrumentals to whoever, right? And so for me, it was kind of happenstance. I discovered music licensing through stock music, right? Because stock music is and was sort of the next evolution of elevator music for a very long time. Up until the point where internet, and I guess that's where you also discovered YouTube, right? When internet got high speeds all over the world, and because it wasn't like that all at all times back in 2008, like 2010. I guess that's when you guys started, Chris. It's Chris, your first name, right?
Oh, well, Carlin, technically. I go by Game Carlin. Busy. Yeah, either one.
Oh, my bad, my bad.
It's all good. Shoot, everybody calls me a different name, so this is whatever. No, but here's something that's a distinct difference is that they for people who aren't in the sync world, for example, like, I mean, like directly talking to a music supervisor, they don't understand turnaround time. Like, for example, if they're like, hey, we have this show coming out for the TBS network, but we need you to make music in the next 48 hours. I don't think producers understand the demand and the actual skill you have to even get into that world of sync. You're mentioning licensing from works that we've already done, and then we just kind of put them in a database, and then the people license from the database. And I also want to tap into the side where that turnaround time, just you have to be so consistent as a brand. If you drop the ball one time, you could lose that relationship with the music supervisor. That's why it's film and sync. I think a lot of people veer away from it because they say it's not popular, but it's because they really can't meet that type of demand and expectation. And they're just like, oh, I'll just deal with artists. What do you think about that perspective of the turnaround time?
Yeah, so I did that for a few years at the beginning of my career. But then music libraries, they really evolved into these public marketplaces. And essentially, that allowed me to never have to do those impossible deadlines anymore. Meaning that now my business is fully automated. I don't do any marketing. I don't do any sales. All I do is I create a product that I know will work on the marketplace. So the mentality is you have to understand what kind of company needs what kind of music for what kind of story or what kind of piece of content. You create that music, you upload it to the music library, and then from there, the music library takes control of it. So they'll do the marketing, they'll do the SEO, they'll do whatever it takes to get thousands and thousands of people on their website. And hopefully, if your product is compelling enough, that's when you make those sales. From those sales, you get obviously the licensing money, so the money up front. But then as they place that music on YouTube, on TV, TV ads and TV shows, then your PRO or publishing rights organization will also send you a check for those sales. So that's what why my business model is so powerful is that the only thing I do is I create music that will sell, or fingers crossed will sell. And from there, the music libraries take over for me.
I love that approach. That's a very entrepreneurial approach because this is a conversation that was started by T-Minus on the CLA Wu channel. Shout out to CLA Wu and everybody who follows CLA Wu. He put me onto a lot of dope people like Monte Booker, T-Minus's stuff, all the Kenny Beats and all them. So what was brought up in T-Minus's view, he was saying how, and forgive me because I'm going off a rough memory, but it was basically the difference between putting your music online. I might be accrediting the wrong person. So I'm saying this with a full disclaimer. This could be 100% wrong. So T-Minus, if you're watching the replay, my fault. But I'm going off a rough memory in saying that producers who send loops to industry producers shouldn't then go to put the loops out to sell them to the public. And I was saying my philosophy is that I'm going to sell my stuff to the public and earn the money in the meantime. And then if somebody picks it up and gets it placed, then we can talk about exclusives and pulling it down and all that type of stuff. Is that what you mean? Like monetize it until it blows up into that big thing? Am I hearing you wrong?
In my case, so I don't produce for anyone in mind. Like I'll just create the songs that I like and then a slew of people can license that song, right? So they'll go on that music licensing marketplace. In my case, the main one is premiumbeat.com, right? So they go on there and they hear this track that they like. You can license it for TV for a higher price tag, or only for internet, and then it'll be a lower tier license for like $50, right? From there, essentially, depending on what the usage is, my PRO will also get busy and track all of the usage for my songs, and they will send me money. So I never deal with exclusives anymore. I never deal with artists. All I do is post the music on the music marketplace and let the checks roll in.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay, so multiple ways of earning money on the same asset. And this is, again, a thought process that people aren't familiar with. I'm trying to think of an analogy that people can really get, because it's, I think about that in the same way I think about people approaching YouTube beats, for example. I said, don't just put a beat on SoundCloud or BeatStars, for example, and then sell it that way. I say, go to monetize your YouTube, put your YouTube video as the way to hear the beat so that you get ad revenue, even if somebody doesn't buy the beat. And if they buy the beat, you get the purchased price for the beat and you get ad revenue. And it's thinking of multiple ways to monetize the same asset. And you've explained it in a really interesting way. Now, let me ask you a more ground level question, because the people who are here are probably don't even know about getting into film and syncing TV. So how do you meet these people? How do you get into that world outside of knowing, you know, the friend who owned a website? Do you network with the people who are, you know, composers or the supervisors and all them? Or do you just go online with it?
That's the thing. I don't. I stopped, because as I got successful at creating music that works, the libraries did all the work for me. And mind you, the libraries are taking 50% of everything my music earns. But even there, it allows me to make multiple six figures. So for me, that was enough, right? I was like, I'm good. Let me just do my thing. Let me just do what I enjoy doing, which is composing music, not have to worry about anything else, not have to do all the marketing, Hoopla, or, you know, the SEO, the blogging, the social media, whatever. I just do music, I post it online on these music marketplaces, and they sell it for me. Now, right. I'd like to compare it to your business model, where you can also do that, meaning that you can compose the same kind of music I do that is aimed for, you know, tech companies and you know, food and beverage companies, beats that you wouldn't necessarily hear on a rap album, if you know what I mean. And from there, you can post your catalog on YouTube, monetize the YouTube channel. You can content ID track the content ID of all of these songs. And then you can do it, become your own music library. That's just a way bigger endeavor. And I think that for most people, the best way is really to start at the bottom with music libraries. That way they just focus on the music, they get good at that. And then if they want to become multimillionaires, then they can branch out and create their own thing through YouTube, Content ID, and then also networking directly with music supervisors if they want.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, indeed. It's all about working smarter, not working harder. I'd rather go to one place that is in contact with 1,000 people than to chase down 1,000 people one by one. It's a lot of energy wasted. So I do see the benefit of going straight to the library and just being a contributor to a library who already has the relationships, instead of trying to, you know, build relationships that could take 6 months, a year, 2 years, just to get a solid enough relationship for somebody to send, to allow me to send something to them. And that's what we're leveraging with these libraries. I guess my question would be, I'm thinking of basic questions. What about competition? What if, you know, the common frustration with folks is that they're going up against 1,000 other producers doing the same thing. So how do you feel about the competition in your strategy?
Yeah, so for the longest time, I was trying to do styles of music or genres that I wasn't as proficient in as what I was proficient in, which is hip hop, disco, funk, and then probably a little bit of EDM, right? And so what I tell my students, because I think we'll get to that shortly, but what I tell my students is this, right? The first thing is to choose a niche. And the niche should be based on what your special skill set is. So for example, if you're a singer, well, maybe you should sing over your beats. If you're a guitarist or a keyboard player, you should highlight those instruments into the beats that you provide the music library with. So play to your strengths, right? And then based on that, I talked about, you know, doing some market research, because you want to know what Apple is using, what Burger King is using, what Aston Martin or Lexus or Ford are using in terms of music for their different pieces of content, whether it be TV ads, little interview pieces on YouTube or reels on Instagram. You know, there's music everywhere. So the idea is to see what the market, where the market is going, where it is right now, what you're good at, and essentially fit those two or three components together. Play to your strengths, compose something that is already used on the market, and then put your own personal twist on that. So for me, for example, I was doing hip hop for the longest time, but then I wanted to reach those tech companies. I wanted placements with Samsung. I wanted placements on car ads and stuff like that. So I started to research this music and started to produce it at the highest level, but with my own little funky, colorful twist, if you will. And that is where I had I no longer had competition, because now I was creating music in my own lane that I knew for a fact that would meet the demands of certain verticals or markets, and nobody could beat me at my own game. So that was how I completely set the competition to the side and really got on the fast lane.
Okay, dope. Because I know I used to use Epidemic Sound for my YouTube videos, for example. And now I'm thinking about the quality, because I want people to understand when they're pitching the film and stuff, it's a certain quality, a certain arrangement type, like using stingers, using versions that are shorter than 5 minute long beats and different things like that. But not only that, in the library that I used to frequent called Epidemic Sound, it was a lot of instruments that just aren't in our DAW. It was a lot of live recording, a lot of live vocals. Now, do they only want instrumentals or do they prefer songs?
I would say they, or at least from my experience, instrumentals will sell more, just because the instrumentals allow the customer to put their own voice over. So for example, if it's a TV ad, they'll need a narrator at some point over the top of the music. But that being said, those libraries still take full songs. The idea is to have lyrics in those songs that can sort of be versatile, allow different companies to use some of the hooks in different perspectives, right? So it can't be really, songs that are too aggressive, songs that are too focused on one idea. It needs to be somewhat flexible from the lyrics point of view. But yeah, so going back to Epidemic Sound, right? I don't know if the listeners know, but Epidemic Sound is worth a few billions, right? So that's just to give the audience an order of magnitude of how big this licensing game it actually is, right? Because Epidemic is only one of several big players, and they're worth billions of dollars. And mind you, we talked about YouTube Content ID, and you're probably paying them just by using them their songs, because once they start to track the usage on YouTube, YouTube Content ID is a $3 billion industry a year. That's the amount of payouts that they had in 2021. So it's huge.
No, I love that. It's the thing, you know what I realize is that people, producers mostly, want to be cool. They don't necessarily want money, they want to be cool. So even though I'm telling people, hey, here's billions over here, like for example, I work with brands directly, $1 billion companies, whether it's Razer, a laptop company, or whether it's a protocol company in Web3 worth billions, it's not Drake. So they're like, okay, if it's not Drake, I don't want to work with it. So a lot of people are coolness motivated, I found, and not money motivated. So it's like we're preaching, you know, hey, here's how you create sustainability for your family. Here's how you increase your income streams. But then only that small pocket of like entrepreneurial type people will actually take that information and run with it. And I guess this is what the conversation is about. I want to lift up a couple people to the stage to really pick up their perspective, because I could try to be them all day long, but what better than to hear from them? Shout out to Liz real quick. She says, I worked for an entertainment law firm a few years ago. Man, so much money they had everyone. So much money they had. Yes. So she's verifying that. When you work with the law firm, you see the transactions, you see the numbers in the contracts that people are paying, you see the money behind stuff, you see the publishing, you see the royalties. Let's pull up a couple of folks to pick their brain, if you don't mind.
For sure. But before you do, I just want to add to what you were saying, because it's so, so true. I see people all the time, they say that their business goals are to, you know, touch the hearts of many and grow a huge following and this and that. Indeed, like, I think the producer community is driven by this glamorous dream of working with Drake or whoever, the Migos, whatever. But it's a totally different thing to actually build a business that allows you to make beats all day, every day. And it's a very, very different mindset. And what I tell producers in my program is this, it's the money or the glory, but you can't have both, or at least not at the beginning. So if you want a career, and if you want to stay at home like JT, and you want to just make beats and get paid, well, then you have to choose the money. And then if you choose the money, all of your decisions are going to be based on exactly that. How can I make the most money from the time I spent in front of the computer or keyboards making beats?
Right on. That's the real perspective in it. And again, I guess what I'm realizing is a lot of people who are flashy on social media the more flashy people are, the less money there usually is behind the scenes. So the more people you see flashing, like, wealth is quiet. It's very quiet. They don't show off, you know, they don't need to brag and all this type of stuff. I think we lost Scuba. So Scuba, if you want to come back up, let me know. I don't know what happened to his mic. But let's let Hype De Niro up. Mm-hmm.
There was this quote by Jay-Z who said, if you can't buy it twice, you can't afford it. So there you go.
Yeah, but you know, it's just because people will complain about not getting paid and all this type of stuff. But we're trying to tell y'all, you know, try this pathway. It's not as cool as a Drake placement. It's not as cool as a XYZ placement, but it's financially stable. Let me let up a couple folks. You guys got to accept the invites. Accept the invites to hop on stage. So we can pick your brain. Hopefully the app isn't glitching on me. There we go. Scuba's back. You can unmute Scuba. All right. He can't find the mute button. There he is. Can you hear us? We can't hear you. Probably doesn't have his settings right, so whatever. We're gonna move you to the audience. Thank you, Scuba, for trying, but it didn't work. So let's start off with maybe a big mistake that people are making, changing lanes into this type of world. What is a huge mistake that you see people make?
Huh, that's a good one. I've never thought of it that way. I think the biggest mistake is not a mistake per se, but it's not being self-aware. Meaning that if you're great on the guitar,
oops, oh, I just exited the thing.
Not playing to your strengths, right? You're not doing something that a whole lot of other producers can't do, and so if you want to win, you got to play to your strength. You can't worry about the next man or the next woman doing whatever they're good at, right? So that's what I think. So you need to look at what you're really good at and just pile on that. Like really, really go hard on whatever you're good at.
Right, because a lot of people, they're like, I make every style, I can do anything. They don't focus. You know, they have this thing to sell, that thing to sell. And if people walk into our store and they see pies, like American pies, and then they see a dirt bike, and then they see a beanie bag chair, they're like, what is this store about? You know what I mean? Like if it just had pies, they'd be like, okay, this is a pie store. I'm going to come here for pies. If they saw a beanie bag, oh, I get it. This is a furniture store, a modern furniture store. And if they see a dirt bike, they go, oh, this is an off-road adventure type store. So they know what they're going to the store for. And a lot of people, they put up all these random items. So when people go to their store, they don't have an identity and they're automatically identified as like a thrift store or a low discount store. And that's how people discount themselves, is when it's too confusing to identify what you are. It's actually why the prices remain low. So you tapped into something pretty deep, actually.
Yeah, well, you too, my friend. But yeah, so if I may, after you've mastered one genre of music, that's when you can actually branch out. So if you're really, really, really good at hip hop, then you should start getting really, really good at EDM, for example, or whatever is in vogue right now. But the idea is to become a master of your craft. And from there, you will have acquired the skills to essentially become great at anything. But you need to first get great at one thing. And so one genre, one type of arrangement, one type of mix, right? And from there, you essentially make that product line a bit bigger.
Speaking of product lines, I was just talking about line extension, because here's where a lot of, this is just a business talk in general, people make a mistake. They'll do, okay, we have Yoohoo chocolate milk. So now people are going, wow, the Yoohoo chocolate milk is popping. Let's do a line extension. Let's make some Yoohoo cereal. And then they start falling off because they're trying to extend this brand into all these different sub niches that don't make any sense. Like BusyWorks Beats is about music production, FL Studio, and music theory. If I tried to hop over into, let's say, the beauty industry, and then I made, you know, BusyWorks Bees lip balm, it may work, but chances are it's not going to work. It's too much confusion when it comes to the core brand. It's too many branches. If your branch is heavier than the tree is going to fall over. And most people don't focus on their tree stem, or what's it called? What's the bottom of a tree called? Not the root, but the, what's the bottom of a tree called? Somebody in the chat, help me out. The core part of a tree. Okay, that has to be solid before you start branching out. If your branch is way more than your tree is going to fall over. So yes, I want to continue picking your brain, because you said you had insights for the producer community. And I really, since this is a world I'm not into, I have friends who are into film and TV more so, who are, you know, giving me opportunities and things. Shout out to Derrico from Priority Beats. We're going to be working with him guys pretty soon. But outside of him just telling me what he does, you know, what's something that you just wanted to really share with the greater audience in the producer community?
Yeah, so
the stump. That's what
I think that the essence of my message is that you want to keep it simple, right? So for example, my business is all about making beats, selling them online. That's it. I'm not trying to chase music supervisors. I'm not doing marketing. I'm not doing sales. I'm doing it in my coaching business. But in the music business, all I do is focus on creating the dopest, coolest, up-to-date product that I think people will want to use in their content, right? And so that's why I sort of go against some of my good friends who are more from the marketing side of things, right? Because I say, if you're trying to build a music production business, you should first and foremost focus on music production, not marketing, not social media, not content creation, not SEO, all these things. Those things are very, very powerful and should come later. But the first step is really to sort of get automated on. Hype Dinero Ovio, you want to chime in?
I had to mute it real quick.
Go ahead.
Wait, was he muted on your end, or is that?
Oh, now you go ahead, man.
My bad.
I don't know. I got invited to talk on here anyway, but I mean, I was just trying to see what perspective he was talking about, like throughout the whole production thing and the, you know, the difference between production and marketing is really not no difference. You know what I'm saying? So it's either way how you it's like automated for certain things in certain ways, but it's really how you integrate it. You know what I'm saying? That's just how I see the music and everything with the web and shit. Oh, excuse my language.
It's all good. It's all good. We got people here of all ages. You're good. You're good. So yeah, let's work off off that perspective. You said basically music production and marketing are integrated. Am I hearing your statement right?
Yeah, it's like it's all in one thing, but it's like how we use it, like one tool, like, you know.
I see. And we'll take that brainstorm or we'll run with it. Thank
you. Is there a difference between how it's automated?
We're going to get into it. We're going to get into it. I'm going to tuck you in VIP just so the screen is like clean and everything. So we keep the background noise to a minimum. But yes, so Hype introduced a good question. Is our music marketing? And I know what he means. Basically, he means when we're making the music, is that the marketing piece to make people want our music? For example, if I work with Nicki Minaj, that's a marketing tool to pull people back to my ultimate platform. That's why Internet Money got so big. They use Juice WRLD's brand to pull people back to the Internet Money kits and all that type of stuff that they have going on. So that's his question from what I'm hearing, Delicate. What's your perspective on using film, sync, and TV stuff to then drive people back to your actual core business and not seeing the TV stuff as like the business, but like a marketing tool?
Well, again, my work is not used by me to create more opportunities. As weird as it may sound, the volume is so large on these music libraries, such as Epidemic, such as Premium Beat, that I don't need to say, for example, use, hey, here's a Lamborghini placement that I got, which by the way happened, which is really cool. But I don't need to use that to get more customers and more money flowing into my business. Now, I like to make the distinction between marketing and music production in that way. So to me, when you're marketing, you're spending time. Time that you're not spending on creating new beats, new products to sell, right? And in my business, I want to be focusing on money-making activities. As far as music licensing, creating content on social media is not a money-making activity. It's not bringing in more license sales and money from my PROs. Therefore, if I want to grow my music licensing business, I'm not going to spend any time on marketing. Does that make sense?
Yeah, because you're putting it in somebody else's system and they basically are handling the traffic of that system, if I'm hearing you right, and you don't want to overly put an effort to another platform, you know, just for them to ultimately control the traffic. Like that's like, when people drive all their, I'm trying to think of an example here. I want to think Amazon, but I don't want to throw shade at Amazon any type of way. Let's just say YouTube. If I drove all my people to YouTube, I'm also driving them in front of competitors. I'm driving them in front of distractions. So yeah, they'll watch my video for a little bit, but then they'll click off to go to somebody else's video. So why would I put 100% of my effort into leading my customers to get distracted? You know, sending them directly to a YouTube video. Is that what you mean by sending the energy over to the licensing platforms?
Yeah, so you're right that I play within the rules of a system, which is the music library. Just as you do with, if you were to pigeonhole yourself into just you doing YouTube, right? But what I'm thinking is, when you're beginning and when you're building your business, it's way too difficult, in my humble opinion, to become a marketing god as well as a music production god. Therefore, you should start with music production. If music production is your main passion in life, right? Some people are as passionate with doing social media marketing, content marketing, SEO, and all these things. But my passion when I started my business was to make beats all day, every day. So that was the system that allowed me to do it. And it is the most effortless because the only thing I do in this business is compose music.
I see. Let's keep picking the brains of the folks so that we can stay on target with their frequency. Scuba, we're going to give this a second try. Let's see if he got his mic plugged up the right way. Yeah. There he is.
Busy, man. What's going on, man? I'm on my laptop now, man. I was on my phone at first, and I didn't have no AirPods and no headphones and my mic, so it was hard for me to hear. So I just got on my MacBook and was transferred over to here.
Oh, gotcha. Wealth MacBook. Let's go. What's going on? How you feeling, man?
For sure, man. Hey, I definitely appreciate y'all for accepting me to invite into the conversation, man, and even being able to have the opportunity to speak with y'all, man. My first question, I definitely, enjoy the content and the conversation of where everything is going, because most of my questions has really already been answered. I've just built it, not built my website, but I have a website that got built. I'm trying to see, is it best for me to, go on let's say a site like BeatStars or something like that to try to promote my music, or is it best to kind of start by myself with, you know, with the website that I have now and try to independently go and get, you know, listeners and try to get my crowd accepting my music and things like that? Is that a good place to start, or should I go to BeatStars and do it like that?
Oh, I think that's a perfect question for so many people who are listening right now. Thank you, Scuba, for that dope question. I'm going to tuck you in VIP just so, again, so it's no background noise. What are your thoughts, Delicate? We'll start with your perspective on it.
I mean, so my question would be, what's the goal here? And if the goal is to sell instrumentals, I would ask the second question, which is, does your site allow customers to either make the transaction themselves on the website, or do they need to use a contact form to make a purchase?
Oh, I guess he couldn't. So I'll be him, metaphorically. Could you ask me that question one more time? You said, does it have a, say it one more time for me in one sense?
Yeah, so Scuba was saying he has a website done, and he's wondering, to get the ball rolling, if he should also get on BeatStars and or other platforms, right? And so my question is, well, what is the main goal, right? Is it to sell instrumentals? If that's the case, does the website allow him to automate transaction on that website, or do the customers need to go in a contact form, for example, and reach out to Scuba to say, hey, Beat such and such names, I want that. What are the prices, for example, right? Because it's a totally different funnel.
I got you. Let's say he has a fully automated Shopify type beat store and he wants to do BeatStars at the same time. What are your thoughts?
I think it's a big challenge, because then you need to drive traffic to two different places. And so, as you said yourself earlier, you don't want to confuse people, right? So if you create an IG, for example, an Instagram account, and you want to send traffic to one of those two platforms, well, you might as well choose your own website and not the BeatStars, because at least when they get to the website, they won't be distracted by other people's beats and whatever else BeatStars has to promote, right? Or if you have that IG and you want to send them both to the website, well, people are going to get confused, because then they'll be like, well, what's the catch here? Should I purchase the beats on Scuba's website, or should I go to his BeatStars? So I would say focus on one thing. And then if you have a website done, well, then the game is all about driving traffic to this bad boy.
Right. And I have a similar philosophy, and I'm starting to learn a little nuance, because today I was looking up this plugin called Oxford Inflator plugin, and I Googled it and I saw three different prices. I saw the Sweetwater price, the Universal Audio price, which is $180, and then I saw Plugin Boutique's price, pardon me, which was a discount off of $150, and it was $40. So I said, even though this thing is listed three times on three different websites, I'm going to go with the cheapest price. And I went to Plugin Boutique and bought the plugin, which I still have to install. I bought it earlier because I want to try it out. And I'm using this experience to expose my new thought about being on multiple platforms. Because when we're building funnels, for example, sometimes websites aren't archived indexed on Google. So they're not even, you can't search for them. So I could have a website where my beats are up and they're discounted. Let's say I usually sell it at 100. Now they're 50 on some kind of secret offline. It's online, but offline website where you can't just Google it. Selling them for $50. Then I have on BeatStars where the price is $100. And so I'm saying all this to say, we can, in a way, there's a justification for having both sites, because on one site you can charge more. And for the people who won't buy it at that higher price, you can then sell it for less, but not in the Google search where they can find it. In other words, if I go to Google and I type in Oxford Inflator, I shouldn't see the price being $150, $39, and then $150. I'm always going to go to the $39 one. If they did it differently, where they all were synchronized and had a secret website that wasn't listed that sold it for $39, the value would still be perceived as $150, but in my email it would say, hey, limited time offer, $39 for whatever, for however much time. And I would buy for the $39. So that way you can either sell people on the front at $150 and they agree, or on the back end you could sell it for $39. You get both prices, and you can handle people who have the price objection specifically. So I have a new perspective on being on multiple sites. I think the issue is usually price. If your price is $100 on one site and the same thing is on another site at a different price, it looks there. People are always going to go with the cheaper price. So I have a new philosophy on sending everybody to my website and only my website. But I do agree with, if you divulge your traffic too much and bifurcate it, then you're not going to be collecting enough data. And I think that's another thing. So what do you think? So do you collect data and email addresses and all that?
I do. But that's only for my coaching business. So let me just reframe a little bit the discussion, right? Because the question about having your own website comes up a lot. Every producer feels like if they want to become professionals, they have or they need their own website. And I think that's sort of passed on from people to people because you see your competition having their own website. Therefore, you feel like you need a website. Now, my advice to beginners or people who are good producers but beginner business owners is driving traffic is as complex as producing music, right? So if you want to start a business and you're not quite there on the music production front, and then you want to tackle a second discipline that is as complex as music production in driving traffic or digital marketing, then you're going to get discouraged because first of all, you're going to try to divide your time onto two money-making activities, music production and digital marketing. And so you're only going to be able to use 50% of your time to make great music. That's why when you start, you should become a master of your craft, become great, great at music production. And once you automate a simple system, such as uploading to either a BeatStars or other automated websites, such as the libraries I work with, then you can start to allocate more time into really researching and getting your knowledge up for driving traffic, digital marketing, social media marketing, and all of these things. Make sense?
Said a lot. If you can give me a kindergarten one sentence, because you gave us a lot of thoughts all at once. And again, some of us are beginner. I'm speaking for my average audience member, which is they're just learning how to make beats. They have these large aspirations to be like a DJ Mustard or be like, a producer who may land his stuff on TV, but they don't really get the businessy side or the like traffic. They don't even know that definition of traffic. I probably should have defined traffic. So just on a kindergartner level, if you could consolidate it, I guess, into one sentence statement for the kindergartners in the room, I think that would help.
Absolutely. So if you want to get your music placed on TV, TV ads, and on internet content, such as YouTube, Instagram, Facebook, what you do is you become great at one genre of music. Great means when you compare your masters with whatever you hear on TV, it sounds the same or better. Once you have said yes to that, right, that your music sounds as good or better than what you hear on TV and whatever reality TV shows, car ads, and then little videos on YouTube and Instagram, then what you want to do is you want to upload your music to Music Library. From there, it's all said and done. You just wait and you let the music collect the money for you. Mm-hmm. And those libraries, they have all the contacts, music supervisors, ad agencies, and businesses directly go on these websites to purchase music every day. So your music might just get picked up. And the beauty of this model is that you get two checks for one song. One check from the beat getting licensed or sold, right? And then once the beat is used, if you're a member of a PRO, such as in the States, it's BMI and ASCAP. In Canada, it's SOCAN. If you're a member of that, then that organization will also send you money as long as they can track usage of your songs online, on TV, on radio, etc. Does that make more sense?
Yeah, and I'm going to introduce the questions from the audience that I could I'm trying to empathize and step in their shoes to see what would they ask. So let's say this. Let's say they think it's too good to be true to upload, because we've all been on YouTube and been on BeatStars, and it's just like upload and pray. But we know to a degree it's relationship focused. How much of this is relationship based, to where people who make those decisions actually choose based on quality versus just the relationship? What's up, Tex? Haven't been a while, Tex. What's up, Tex? So my question back to that is, what percentage do you think is relationship based and not just skill based?
So my approach is 100% skill based, meaning that my music speaks for itself, right? But as we've said earlier, I am also trapped in this system, meaning that if Premium Beat doesn't like my songs, they won't push them, they won't make it to the top of the listings in different genres, and therefore I'm not gonna move any units. So if you're not satisfied with that, then you can take matters into your own hands, relating to your second example, where you can actually reach out to ad agencies, you can reach out to music supervisors, you can reach out to people who create trailers, and essentially just introduce yourself, show value, and then from there, you can do essentially the whole licensing sales yourself.
Right, which is tough, because at that point, it would become, like you said earlier, I'm trying to think of the proper word, like a creative agency, which is what me and my mentor are going to be creating soon for a lot of Web3 stuff. So then people would really have to have their stuff together, trademarks, licensing agreements. You basically have to form a business on paper and know it, you know, keeping up with the communications. That becomes a whole operation. So I can see it's a difference in mindset, where this approach is more for a contributor who focuses on one deliverable style, puts it in a pot, and then we're bundling up a bunch of contributors. You have one person doing trap, one person doing EDM, one person doing, R&B. So you have all the genres, bundling them up, and then they package all these things together as a bundle to say, here's the bundle company number one, choose your favorite flavor of ice cream, basically. And then that company chooses. I still think on some level, there's a politics when it comes to that type of stuff. I don't know to the degree. I do know radio is extremely political, because I just got off of a conversation about the Toronto scene and how connected the DJs are to radio and to the artists who are coming up. So it's a very political thing. I'd be curious to know the data about, you know, how people make these decisions. But ultimately, the person who made that relationship to even get them to use the platform is the one who controls how people perceive the music. And I guess from that point, they go, either we're looking to attract the hip hop demographic, you know, we need EDM because, it, you know, it's a different vibe for each, advertisement or scene or whatever the case may be. And then my last question from this beginner point, because I want to keep it within an hour, is what do you think about the supply? And I'm asking about the supply and demand aspects, because I would think that if we're putting music on a platform that's used to be licensed, does it need to be new music all the time? Or are we just trying to fill the supply until the supply is met? Until the demand is met. Does that make sense? In other words, do they need the newest trap beat, or are they going to use the trap beat that was submitted 6 years ago? So by submitting more trap beats, I'm just kind of overly supplying the platform.
Well, I think that in music licensing, the music is sort of watered down, right? Meaning that if you listen to, for example, a Coca-Cola commercial and there's a trap beat in there, it's not going to be the same type of trap beat you hear on a Migos or Drake record, right? So in the music licensing world, you have to sort of broaden your harmonic and melodic palette and use whatever is crucial and most important in a genre. For example, in trap, it's the rattlesnake hi-hats, the 808s, right? But then melodically speaking and harmonically speaking, you can do pretty much anything you want. You can throw funky brass over those 808s for all I care, right? And actually, that actually might make up for a great new blend of styles. But going back to supply and demand. So my philosophy is kind of like, I'm an Apple fanboy. So to me, keeping the lineup small, but at the highest of quality, will make it so that your catalog has a longer lifespan. So to your point, will the six-year-old trap beat sell? Well, if it's high quality and it still makes sense in 2022, sure. But if it's really trapped in an era or in a trapped in time, right, and it sounds like whatever people were doing in 2015, well then, unfortunately, in 2022, it's not going to move as many units, right? Another thing, and I know we're wrapping up the show, but you talked about Amazon earlier, and I was really curious to see where you were going with that. But to me, that's exactly it, right? If you're selling, I don't know, some kind of cookware, right? You have way more chances to sell 1,000 units a month throwing them on Amazon.com than you will ever just selling on your own website, right? Just because there are millions of people looking for cookware every day on Amazon, whereas they've never heard of your .com, right?
Right, yes. So I guess the Amazon approach I was gonna take, I think ultimately I had to think about it for a second. What I measure is the leverage I can get out of the relationship with a platform. So for example, YouTube is a platform where I'm a contributor. I'm at the bottom level of the pyramid. I'm contributing supply for YouTube's machine. But I, in my perspective, because I can leverage and gain more in return by giving than not giving, if, for example, if I never put my stuff on YouTube and I put it up on a blog website, the traffic would probably be 1,000th, you know, the traffic I would get from YouTube. So if the benefit outweighs the cost, then I'll do that trade. The same way, if we had, you know, a merchandise line, for example, and we can get 100 times the traffic on Amazon, it'd be more prudent to go on Amazon to get the traffic and the revenue and then use all that capital to build our own platform later than to try and, you know, bootstrap our platform and make less revenue for longer periods of time and then miss the window from Amazon. And then we're still at the bottom. We didn't earn enough money. So that's, I think when people choose to be a contributor, the benefit has to outweigh the cost of being a contributor, because when we're contributors, we're ultimately at the bottom of some system, because contributors contribute content and supply to a bundler like a manager. And then that manager supplies those bundles to the ultimate client, which is the entrepreneur in this case, or the ad agencies, TV, you know, all the projects that are going on. So it just has to make sense. You know, everybody's situation is a little bit different. And if they can't start their own pyramid or manage their own pyramid, you got to be a part of somebody else's pyramid. That's why the pyramid's on the dollar. If you guys understand the pyramid, it'll all make sense.
I absolutely agree with what you just said. And correct me if I'm wrong, but you built your platform starting at the bottom on YouTube, right?
Yes, as a contributor, yeah. Right.
Exactly. So when you did that, you sort of climbed up the pyramid, and then you wanted more control, and then you had a better business acumen making or enabling you to take more difficult decisions to grow your business, right? But you had to start at the bottom. And so that's why I'm saying, as producers, the simplest way to start at the bottom is to become a contributor, as you so eloquently put it. And from there, once you get the ball rolling and you start to generate income, then you can branch out and create your own thing. But to make it even more simple for folks out there, you have to ask yourself two questions. The first question is, what are you most passionate about? Is it the music production side of things? Or is it, for example, the networking with artists? Because it's totally two totally different things, right? What a Murder Beats does is totally different from what I do, for example, right? Obviously, it's not the same amounts of money that we bring in, but you get the point, right? And then the second question is, well, like we talked about earlier, is what is your business goal? Is it the money or is it the glory? Do you want to just get into photo shoots in the studio with fancy A-listers such as Drake? Or do you just want to feed your family, stay at home, make the things that you're passionate about, aka making beats, and get on with your life, right? So those are the two things you have to ask yourself before starting to build your business.
Right, and that's funny because I was talking to an artist. I was like, do you plan on going on tour? That's the number one question I asked artists, because if their answer is no, then we have to take a content approach. They become more of a content creator than a performing artist, which is a different thing. And I just want to thank Delicate Beats. I want to keep this concise because I have plans to get an exercise before my next conversation that I have to have. So I'm on a time schedule right now. And Delicate Beats, is there, where can, because your name's different on Instagram, that's what threw me off for a while. Where can people follow up with you as far as just learning more about what you have going on?
Absolutely. So the first thing is to follow me on Instagram, and you're right, I changed the name. It's now Produce with JT, because my name is JT, and that's the name I used to pen my book. So follow me on Instagram, it's Produce with JT. And then if you are thinking that what I talked about today is too good to be true, even though it is too good, and it is true, you can pick up my book, The Bedroom Super Producer. It's available on Amazon, Audible, or on my website, which you'll get the link if you follow me on Instagram. So those are the two like starting points, because I throw on my Instagram a whole lot of free quick tips about the music licensing game, about composition, production, mixing, mastering, and business. And then in the book, I really break it down for you guys to understand, guys and girls, pardon me, for you guys to understand what it is that I do, how I did it, and we break it down to how you can become very efficient and up your game 10 times.
Good man, good man. And we just appreciate you being in a giving spirit, because a lot of people, I just put up a story recently, a lot of people like to hold it, because Pharrell said, what do you say, share the codes. That's my new phrase for 2022, share the codes. In other words, share the wisdom with the community. So thank you. I'm on a time crunch, guys. I got to do life stuff for the first time in my life. I got a life stuff to do. I'm going to go exercise and get ready for this next thing that I have to do. So thank you, Delicate Beats, and we will connect and continue this conversation soon enough.
For sure. Thank you so much for having me, Carlin. And yeah, I'll do some life stuff as well, I guess.
Some life stuff. Thank you, buddy. Yeah, I
got to go. That sounded wrong, did it? But yeah, no, I need to train also, so it's a good reminder.
Good man, good man. Thank you, buddy. I'll catch up with you. Oops, I don't think I did that right. Whoops, let me do this again. And how do I end rooms on here? End stage, bang, okay. So yes, that is Delicate Beats. You guys can learn more about him. I just wanted to have that conversation and share it with you. Instead of just doing a phone conversation, I like to just share conversations live to show you guys, to give you insight so I don't have to repeat it to you, basically. I'm gonna get walking before the sun goes down because it's good temperature here and I gotta catch it while I can. And what else do I have to tell y'all? That's it. So we'll have more conversations. Today I have another conversation scheduled for 6 p.m. Eastern time on Instagram. Someone asked me, they're gonna, I guess, pick my brain on something on Instagram. And then 7 p.m. Eastern time, we're going live on Clubhouse to have a conversation about music producers specifically, music production specifically. So thank you, DJ Wraith. Thank you, DJ Rob Snow. Everybody else is here. Tex even popped up. Mind Beats is here. We got Diavani in here. We got Maine in here. Liz was here earlier. Thank you. Marcy T, what's up? Channel's here. So I'm going to let you guys go. I'm not going to hold you too long. I got life. So peace. I'll catch you guys at 6 p.m. Eastern time on Instagram, and then 7 p.m. Eastern time on